Okay, thank you, Vincent. Can you hear me well?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. So good morning for most of you in the US. I gave a presentation about this topic. I think it was like 1 year ago or so. So I'm just going to show today what we have achieved in the last year. So this is a short overview of my talk today. First, I will give a short introduction, very short. Then I will go directly into the project. I will go through the project iteration one and the iteration two. That is what we have been working mainly in the last year and a bit. And then some ideas for the future that we have for continuing the project. So I think that most people in the call must know now that PRIDE stands from Proteomics Identifications Database. Is the largest repository of proteomics data worldwide, and PRIDE stores mass spectrometry-based proteomics data, vector and protein expression, post-translational modifications. We have raw data and peak lists to store as much technical and biological metadata as possible. And we have been focused for all these years in tandem MS approaches. So just to show you that really PRIDE is growing a lot, I have included this slide. It's already like 3 months old or so. So we have much more data now, but just to give you an idea that really PRIDE receives contributions from people from all over the world. There are now over 4,000 data sets from over 51 countries and more than 1,700 groups. At the moment, the data volume PRIDE is about 250, so it has grown a little bit since this slide was generated. I just want to mention that every month, average, we are receiving now between 150 and 160 data sets. So you can see here the really significant growth that we have been having in the last few years. And actually, I have to say that the US is our main contributor in terms of data sets submitted. But of course, there's a lot of data there. But what is I would like to say is that the data sets are being reused more and more. And this is relatively new for proteomics. This was the case before, it has been the case already for quite a few years for genomics, transcriptomics, but it's really becoming to be a common thing to do in proteomics as well. So last year, only last year, 2015, about 200 terabytes were downloaded from PRIDE. We have some statistics about which were the most downloaded data sets. This is not the point now. But again, I just wanted to highlight that the data sets have been used more and more. If someone wants to have a look about what people are doing with the data, we wrote this review paper like 1 year ago or so that you can read in proteomics. So I wanted to give this short introduction about before going into the project, because PRIDE Cluster in a way represents also our way here in-house to reuse all that data and take advantage of it, all that data has been submitted by proteomics groups from all over the world. So we started the project in 2012, more or less, so already 4 years ago. So this is why I call it iteration one. So the idea at the time was to provide a QC filter peptide-centric review of PRIDE, because as you know, most of you know, data in PRIDE is stored as originally analyzed by the submitters, and data has a heterogeneous quality, and it's difficult to make the data directly comparable. So we started the project to enable assessment of published proteomics data, which is a prerequisite for data reuse in other resources. So I explained this 1 year ago, but I will explain it again today. The basic concept is that we take all MSMS spectra in PRIDE, the ones that are publicly available, of course. We also take the original identifications that were submitted by the authors, and then we do spectrum clustering on our site. The spectrum clustering process is based on spectrum similarity. We initially used dot products. Now we are using a slightly more complicated algorithm, but at the end the difference is not that high. So at the end, we have all these spectra, and this spectra get grouped in spectrum clusters. And in this case, in this particular case, imagine that we have five spectra that are included in this cluster. So in this case, we would retain this identification, this one, and would say that this is more reliable than this one that was only present in one of the original spectra. So at the time, we use a threshold that at least 10 spectra in a cluster need to be present, and the ratio between the ratio in which one identification needed to be majoritary was at least 70%, and we reached that number using support vector matching approach. So this is basically the concept. We have here one cluster that corresponds to this very long peptide sequence. In this case, we have that almost 98% of the PSNs included in that cluster correspond to that particular sequence. So we would say that this identification is a good one, and we consider this to be reliable, while we would discard the other ones in terms of QC purposes. So I will come back to this later again. So I will have time to explain this again in more detail. So we published this originally in Nature Methods in 2013. At the time, we cluster all public identifier spectra in Pride. We did it using our local SF computer farm, and at the time we clustered 21 million identified spectra, just to run up the numbers. And basically this is what we did at the time, and it worked very well, and we used it for this QC purposes internally in Bright. And then is where I'm going to start talking about the iteration 2 of the project. The iteration 2, I just have to explain why. So so we did this in 2012. Of course, the paper got published a little bit later in 2013. But really, when we wanted to repeat again the process, like a few months later actually, we realized that Pride Archive had really experienced a huge increase during that year, because it was the first year of protein exchange, and that was the reason. And also, we wanted to develop an algorithm that could also work with unidentified spectra. And of course, for that, the algorithm needed to be much more robust and be able to work with a much larger amount of data. Because of course, about 80% of the spectra in Pride are unidentified. So this rationale is what made us to develop the second iteration of the algorithm. And for that, we use a technology that is called Hadoop. Apache Hadoop is open source. And what it does is parallelizes work among different machines. We are very lucky here at EBI that we have a Hadoop cluster. And we also had an expert in-house at the time. So I'm not going to get into details about the technical implementation. If someone has questions about this, please ask me later. But basically what we did is we repeated the process, considering all the spectra, public spectra in Pride, in this case in April 2015, so 3 years later more or less than the original paper. In this case, the important thing to consider is that we consider all spectra, both identified and unidentified, and at the end we came up with a total of 28 million clusters. As I said, in this case we use the new algorithm that uses Apache Hadoop as the main technological framework, and this was really published very recently in Nature Methods in August, so a couple of months ago. So this is where the website where all the data can be accessed. You can go here, and if you click on search, you will go to the list of peptide sequences that correspond to the different clusters. Again, I'm just going to show one example. Of course, in these cases, you always try to show first the example that works very well. So this is the example of one perfect cluster. It corresponds to this particular sequence. In this case, a spectra coming from four different species. So because I forgot to mention before that we mix all spectra. We don't mix spectra split by different species. So in this case, we got one perfect cluster with 880 PSMs, all of them originally identified the same peptide sequence. And all this came from 28 different projects and for different species. So just to show you that the approach works really well. And in this case also, it was clear that they came from the same instruments. If you go to that particular page in the website, you can also have access to the annotated spectrum of the consensus spectra of the cluster, and then there are other charts related to the range of the precursor OMSC value or the spectrum similarity values. But so we did this, as I said, considering identified and unidentified spectra. For the identified spectra, is basically the same rationale that we followed before. But what I'm going to explain a little bit more in detail in the rest of the presentations is are the new findings that we were able to get in this second iteration of the study. So the of course, and this was the idea that we have from the beginning, was to use the spectrum clustering algorithm to shed some light incorrectly or unidentified spectra as well. So that's why, again, we mix identify and unidentified spectra in this second iteration of the project. So the output of the analysis, I'm going to split it in three parts, what we call inconsistent spectrum clusters. The second clusters including identified and unidentified spectra. And the third point is clusters just containing unidentified spectra. So I will explain each of these points in more detail. So again, the first group of analysis that I wanted to explain is those clusters that are considered to be inconsistent. So what does it mean? So again, we take all spectra, all of them have their corresponding vector sequence, and at the end, in the cluster, what happens is that we don't have a majoritary sequence. So in this case, the threshold that we follow is that no sequence in the cluster has a proportion larger than 50%. And why does it happen? So we reanalyze around 4,000 large, containing more than 100 spectra, inconsistent clusters, using different approaches like PECNOVO, that it does the novel sequencing, SPECTRA-ST for spectral searches, and extending as the, let's say, the more conventional search engine. And then what we found out is that some of these clusters were identified as spectra as originated from contaminants, so mainly keratins, trypsin, albumin, and hemoglobin. So in this case, in our opinion, it is quite likely that a contaminants database was not used in the search, in the original search by the authors. So the original authors, they didn't use a contaminants database, they submitted the data to PRIDE like that. What happens there is that basically the identifications that the different spectra get are random, because the actual sequence, the corresponding to the contaminant, is not included in the search database. So I just want to illustrate this example with one example that Johannes, the person who did all the work, he found this paper. Again, this was a while ago, in that the authors found that this peptide sequence, this particular peptide sequence, corresponded to one possible biomarker, and they elaborated all their paper about that. But when we were looking for this particular sequence in pre-cluster results, I mean, of course, this sequence corresponds to what they actually were claiming. But when we were actually looking for that particular sequence in pre-cluster, we realized that this sequence was often found in the same cluster with this other sequence here, so this VATBSLPR. And then when we blasted that sequence, we found out that that sequence corresponded to trypsin. So what we think is happening in that case is that, of course, the authors didn't include trypsin or any other contaminants in the database that they used for the initial search. And this is the kind of mistakes that we have found. At least this is our hypothesis. The second point is a bit more interesting is that we, using this in this second iteration of the project, we found around 9 million around 9 million identified spectra were contained in clusters with a reliable identification. So this is basically what we say mixed clusters. So that means that both identified and unidentified spectra are found in the same cluster. So what we claim is that using this clustering algorithm, we could infer identifications or originally unidentified spectrum. So these are candidate new identifications, and of course they need to be confirmed. We are not claiming that the clustering algorithm is enough. Then you should again run your search with the proper parameters to be sure that those spectra are actually there. So what, as an example, and again I don't have too much time to go into the details, we found that around 50,000 reliable clusters contain phosphorylated peptides, and many of them came from non-enriched studies. So we mixed together, of course, enriched studies with non-enriched studies, and we found that some unidentified spectra in those non-enriched studies corresponded to phosphorylated peptides. So again, I'm not going to talk too much in detail about this. What I want to say is that, of course, all this would need to be confirmed. This is just a first estimation, and if someone finds this, of course, the next thing that one will need to do is to run again the search using the proper search engine settings. Maybe the conclusion of the study that was more interesting was that we found consistently unidentified clusters across all datasets in Pride. So in fact, 19 million clusters contain only unidentified spectra, and we analyzed about 42,000 of them that contain more than 100 spectra. We also check, and we use one tool to do this, and most of them are likely to be derived from peptides, so we can say that not 100% of them, but most of them are likely to be derived from peptides, so they shouldn't be artifacts, they shouldn't be small molecules, or other artifacts that could come from the protocol that is following the lab. What we think is that they could correspond to PTNs that they were not considered originally in the search, or to variant peptides that were not included in the original search space. With various methods, we found likely identifications for about 25% of the cases, but what I also want to say here is that really vast amount of data mining remains to be done, because again, we only found explanation for 20% of them. And again, this 20% is for those that clusters that are larger than 100 spectra. There are many more that emphasize less than 100 spectra. One of the things that we did, apart from running again PECNOVO, SPECTRA-ST, and Extandem, was to run an open modification search with all these clusters. This is the example for all the human clusters, again, larger than 100 spectra. And this is this is the same result with different resolution, and this is the highest resolution. We can find that there are some delta masses that are found more often than others, and there's also normal that there is a lot around zero, of course, because it depends also on the way the software chooses the precursor. But again, we found some modifications that are some delta masses that are likely to be modifications that are already well reported, but we also found many other delta masses that that we don't know exactly what they could be. So all the data that we always do in Pride, all the data is publicly available for everyone, is in the Pride cluster result. We, for the identified spectra, we provide spectral libraries for 16 species. But also we provide the clusters of unidentified spectra. They are also available, at least the largest ones, for the main species, human, mouse, and Arabidopsis. And this is what we said is a spectral archive of Pride. This is the first spectral archive, because a spectral archive means that it contains both identified and unidentified spectra. All clustering results are made available, as well as a specific subsets of interest. And of course, as we always do as well, the source code for the algorithm and the Java API is also available. It's actually open source and is available in GitHub. So what I've been saying to many people is that really we want you to have a look at the data and reanalyze it. It would be very nice that some external groups would get involved in this effort to try to unravel what these unidentified clusters could be. And of course, we have some ideas for the near future to continue the projects. We are improving the internal pipeline to run the clustering algorithm. As you can see, as you can imagine, it's quite challenging to run it internally, because there is more and more data all the time. So we need to be able to be scalable. And on top of that, what we are doing is we are applying the algorithm to individual or small groups of similar proteomics datasets that are generated by collaborators. So because we think that the algorithm can be used to target the spectra that are consistently unidentified in these small datasets as well. Again, the idea is that this unidentified spectra could represent PTMs or sequence variants, and then we would try more expensive computational analysis methods like spectral searches or the novel searches. And also something that has been done as well is to apply the same clustering algorithm to MSMS lipidomics studies. And actually, it worked actually quite well as well. So this is a publication where you can read some of the output of an initial study that was done. So I think that's it. Just as a summary, I would say that using a big data approach, we were able to get extra knowledge from all public data in Pride Archive. This is really our take on the problem, but of course, there are many people that are doing nice and cool things with the data. I would say that spectrum clustering enables QC in proteomics resources such as Pride Archive, with the rationale that I explained before. What is really new, and we were the first ones who were able to do it, is it's possible to detect spectra that are consistently unidentified across hundreds of data sets. And it is quite feasible that many of them could correspond to peptide variants or to peptides with PTS not initially considered in the search. And again, we think that the spectrum clustering is applicable in analysis of individual data sets and not only for proteomics. And to finish, I really want to acknowledge especially Johannes Gries. Johannes Gries is the person who has been doing most of the work, and he's the one who has most of the merit in these two iterations of the cluster that I explained. Also, I want to acknowledge Rui Juan. Rui is no longer in the team, but he was the person who did most of the infrastructure-related work, the Hadoop algorithm, for instance, with some collaboration, for instance, from Steve Lewis. And also, Jacet has done a lot of work for the project, and also, of course, Henning, and actually I took some slides from him. And other former members of the team, like Noemi and Jose. And that's it. I'm open from questions. Thank you very much.